Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Joel Bell. I'm the chairman of the Chumir Foundation for Ethics and Leadership, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you all here tonight on behalf of the foundation and our partners, particularly the Munk School for Global Affairs, whose director, Janice Stein, is here somewhere, and the others that you see from Vienna and Toronto noted in your program. We took the opportunity of the Vienna Philharmonic spending an extended period in North America to mount a dialogue that has gone on now for a couple of weeks. It started in New York with a conference there, continues here, and later this week we'll go to Calgary. Many of us take a great deal of pleasure in the music of the Vienna Philharmonic, in the art, the culture of Austria and of Vienna. And it leads us to be very interested in where that all comes from, how that came to be, the center it is for music and for art, what use has been made, what misuse has been made of art in that environment, how things changed, and what lessons we might learn for policy and action today in the field of cultural policy. If you love that culture, and perhaps if you have friends there and you read history, you're forced to ask yourself the question, what are they, your friends in Austria, doing about that, the painful history, the painful parts of that history? If you care about a healthy society, we as a foundation are focused on dialogue for the making of choices for the betterment of our community, then when there is some response, when they start to do something about that history, when there's a willingness to enter dialogue, there's remembrance and recognition, commemorative performances and activity going on, then we have to ask ourselves the question, do we continue to preoccupy ourselves with allocation of blame for a past, or do we change our perspective and participate in that dialogue, in that commemoration, and look for constructive action today? If we are to avoid the repetition of that history, then we also look through the lens of that past and ask ourselves, where are the risks, where are the trouble spots today, and what can we do about them, and how might we do something about them? So those are the subjects that we as a foundation put forward and found an enthusiastic response from both our friends in Vienna and the community here. By your turnout, you demonstrate to us that these are important issues for you. If you're in the business that we are of encouraging dialogue on an enlarged and extended basis, you're our reward, the fact that you have shown up in such numbers tonight, and we appreciate that. We have a stellar panel to discuss these issues. The moderator will introduce them in a moment. I just want to say a particular word about two of the members who have flown for one day from Europe to be with us for tonight. Valentin Inzko, Ambassador Inzko, the High Representative of Bosnia-Herzegovina, who will leave, in fact, tonight after this session to get back to Europe. And Professor Rathkolb, Oliver Rathkolb, who has not only come this time for one night, but this is the third time he's crossed the ocean with a day on the side that he was then going to, whether it was returning to Vienna for a day or coming here for a day. And we owe a great deal of gratitude to them, particularly to Oliver, who has been involved also for some months now with us in the design and conceptualization and informing of this symposium. We have regrets from one individual who was noted in the program, Ivo Komšić, mayor of Sarajevo, whose city hall was partially destroyed, whose archives of the Ottoman and Habsburg period were also lost in the recent events in Bosnia-Herzegovina. I'd like to just somewhere, I don't see him here because he's in a control room, say a word of thanks also to David Naiman, who has put together an extraordinarily high-quality technical capturing of our events in New York. We'll do the same here and in Calgary, so that you can watch these activities at your leisure on our website as well. I've been asked to introduce Carol off, but she needs no introduction to this audience. She's the ideal moderator as someone who has reported in the world of arts, who's reported on international policy and conflict, who's written about that, and who, as you all know, has a daily program that deals with the contemporary domestic and international issues. And with that, I'm going to say thank you to Carol. I should add, not only for tonight, but Carol did come to New York and moderate a panel there and spent the week with us in dialogue to prepare for the follow-up on this program. So I have a great deal of gratitude for her. I thank you, Carol, and I turn everything over to you.
Thank you, Joel. It's a very nice introduction. The name of the program is CBC As It Happens, just in case you don't know what he's referring to. Yes, good. We have an... And I want to also reinforce what Joel just said about David Naiman, who's done such an extraordinary job at making this work tonight. We actually have the person who is directing this production is probably the most multiple award-winning director you could possibly have. I don't know how many awards Geminis he's won. Freddie Parker, who is extraordinary. And you can tell by this, everyone knows, but this camera alone, you know how much effort this takes. And so if you were thinking that maybe this was the NIS or the State Department or Stephen Harper watching all of us, this is not Big Brother. This is, in fact, an extremely expensive piece of equipment that's doing a very impressive job. I'm very privileged to be on the stage with these men, and especially on the Feast of St. Patrick. I'm sure you all would rather be in a pub. No, I know you wouldn't. But the reason why we're so far back is because there will be Irish dancers that come on stage during the show. Again, I'm kidding. But we will raise a glass later in honor of the patron saint of the Irish. I'm going to introduce the panel, starting on this side with Valentin Inzko, who himself is also going to have to leave suddenly this evening to catch a plane back to where he works. He's the High Commissioner for Bosnia-Herzegovina. And I'm surprised and happy to have him here because, as you know, it's extremely tense times in Eastern Europe. And these are affecting, what's happening in Ukraine is affecting Bosnia-Herzegovina. And even before that, though, in recent weeks, much turmoil in that country because we've seen the strongest challenge yet, probably, to the Dayton Accords. Ambassador Inzko has shown he has a very steady and very fair hand in dealing with a lot of people who are very open to change right now, if you can put it mildly. He has served in many other diplomatic posts. He is Austrian by birth, but he is Slovene by heritage, I believe. Yes. And we hope to tap into all his wide knowledge and experience this evening. Next to him, closer to home, University of Toronto's Randall Hansen, director of the Center for European, Russian, and Eurasian Studies at the Munk School of Global Affairs. And he was hired for this gig before anyone realized just how prescient that would be. Or maybe they did know how prescient that would be, Joel Bell. He's an expert on migration and citizenship and on the effects of war on civilian populations. And I know he is not a man who is afraid of controversy. Among the many books he has written, an extraordinary book that I urge you all to read, Fire and Fury, The Allied Bombing of Germany, 1942 to 1945. You can imagine what trouble that stirred up in this country. He has knowledge of how nations and societies do and don't confront difficult truths, and that's what we're dealing with tonight. The final two gentlemen from my other side were strangers to me a month ago, but I have come to know and respect them immensely. Over the week that we were in the symposia in New York City, these two men faced tremendous pressure and resistance from all directions, and they were determined to reveal painful truths about their society and its most treasured institutions, including the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra, of which Clemens is not only an accomplished musician, but he is also first chair. And he is a man who did not need the grief of taking on the project he took on. He's first chair of the Vienna Philharmonic. He is an accomplished musician and professor. His own personal quest for the truth led him into the very dark past of his beloved orchestra. He initiated crucial research into the orchestra's Nazi history, and he found it very unsettling. He put names, faces, and histories to the Jews who were expelled and murdered from his own orchestra. He did not flinch from finding out how recent that Nazi sympathy remained within his institution. And he has been a force for change in his orchestra and in his society, and I admire him greatly. To his right, Oliver Rathkolb is one of Austria's most respected and influential historians. He is the one who led the research team that plumbed the hidden archives of the Vienna Philharmonic. He revealed the extent of the Nazification of the orchestra far more than anyone had realized, and he showed the persecution of Jewish orchestra members who were expelled and murdered. He's helped to challenge Austria's doctrine of being the first victim of Hitler, and he has revealed that Austria was, in fact, a much willing accomplice. His most recent revelations have been just months ago, after 75 years of secrets. And that is our panel. Let's have a warm welcome for these men. The focus tonight, as Joel has mentioned, is on Vienna. But as they say in my business, first the news. And we know that yesterday there was an extraordinary event. It seems not so large, perhaps, on world affairs, but we know how quickly these things can become much larger. There was a referendum in the Crimea where 93% of those who voted in favor of joining Russia and leaving Ukraine. That referendum would not take no for an answer. It was backed up by thousands of foreign soldiers with unknown and mysterious orders. Some of them were from Serbia. It had minorities boycotting that vote. The opposition was barred and the media was unplugged. I just want to ask each of these men, before as we begin, to explain what echoes they felt and thought of as they observed what happened yesterday. I'm going to begin with Ambassador Inzko.
Well, when I was 7 years old, on our borders happened something terrible. It was the Hungarian uprising, you know, when Hungarians wanted to be more independent of Soviet Union. And this uprising was crushed in 56. This was the first event which I remember, yeah, from my childhood. The second one, I was a young sort of temporary journalist, yeah. It was 68 when Czechoslovakia was occupied on the 21st of August in 68. I worked in a newspaper, in a small newspaper, and I remember every detail how this happened. Later, I had also the privilege to work in free Czechoslovakia, and I translated the book of Václav Havel, the famous book To Live in Truth, because he thought, if you live in communism, you live in lie, yeah, in lies. And all these memories came now alive when I have read what happened yesterday in the Krim area. And today we read that it was not annexed or sort of, yeah. It went back to Russia, but it's now an independent state. We have read it today in the news, and it's have been recognized by Russia as an independent state. Yeah. Of course, this is a breach of international law, and international community has already reacted. There are sanctions from the United States and also from European Union, which has today a Foreign Affairs Council in Brussels. And we all admire the brave Ukrainian people.
Thank you. Professor Hansen.
Yeah, I mean, I think 1956 is in many ways the most apt historical analogy for reasons that you've outlined. And there's several things we could think about there. One is that we have to be very careful about promising Ukraine and the Ukrainian people something that we're not prepared to deliver, which was one of the very tragic mistakes of the Hungarian Revolution. If we want to go back further, though, and think about 1938, we have to think about the dangers of historical analogy, and Munich has been invoked multiple times over the last few weeks. And the last time Munich was invoked was Iraq in 2003, and we can all remember what sort of disaster that led to. So one of the lessons of this is to be very careful about historical nationality. The other lesson really depends on what Putin's plans are. I don't think there's any evidence that we'd be prepared to go to war for Ukraine, as sad as that conclusion may be. But if indeed, and this is in dispute, his ambitions extends to the Baltic states, then indeed, if NATO is to have any credibility whatsoever, we would have to be prepared for war. Whether or not, we'll see over the next few weeks.
Very different perspective from you, Professor Clemens, I think.
The only thing is what came into my mind, that was we had a series of concerts in Moscow last November, playing all Beethoven symphonies, and it came spontaneously in my mind, what would we have done if we now wouldn't have traveled to New York, but if it would have been the other way around, that we would have been in November in New York and now in Moscow, then all the discussions would come up. What is then in such a case? Should artists then play in such a country or not? We would have an enormous discussion internal.
What would have been your inclination?
I think that arts has a message beyond politics and beyond our ego. I think we are obliged to bring the message. Then when people would say that's propaganda, other would say no, it gives hope to people who are unterdrückt, was ist,
suppressed.
Yeah. That's always this discussion. And I would say no, as an artist we have to deliver this message.
We will turn to this theme. Professor Rathkolb.
It's interesting. I have different memories than the High Representative to Bosnia-Herzegovina. I was in Prague in July 1968, and you really already could feel the invasion. And later on, I moved to Yugoslavia and felt the fear that also Yugoslavia might be attacked by the Warsaw Pact at that time. I don't have this similar feelings right now, and hopefully I'm not mistaken. But what really causes me a lot of troubles is that nowadays we are talking a lot about World War I, the anniversary and the situation before the war, which is in many instances quite similar to the situation we are nowadays. Before 1914, we had the first globalization, international economy was booming, migration, innovation, technological advancements, economic boom, and also economic decline, problems on the stock market, and so on. And therefore, I think there is something in the air in 2014. And therefore, I think it's very important that the international community, be it the European Union, be it the United Nations, be it the US, finds a way to contain this situation. And also, what I think is even in the next step, more important than containing the situation in the Ukraine and after the separation of Crimea, is to, at first, I think, the first lesson is that the European Union needs really a deep reform to be able to act in comparable cases of crisis. Yeah, that's still like in the war in Yugoslavia, there are different national interests involved in the decision making of the European Union. I think the European Union must take another form of also global leadership on this sense. The second issue is I think we should find ways to minimize or at least reduce our economic dependence on Russia over the next decade. I think this is something we are really dancing on a volcano if you take our gas and oil imports, and I think this is also something we must be aware of. A third issue, which is very important, which was, in my opinion, misused by Putin and the Russian government, is the situation of minorities. And you rightly focused on the Baltic states. And I must also say that, unfortunately, the European Union is not very much interested concerning the situation of the Russian minorities there. And I think now it would be also important, as a clear sign that the European Union is acting in a different way than Russia, really to find a better way to give autonomy rights to Russian minorities in the Baltic countries. I think there is a lot to do, and there is a strong responsibility on this side of the European Union right now.
And I want to stay with 1914. I just want to tell you that if gas and oil is an issue, we might be able to get a pipeline to you. I think we have it's always a possibility, and if you say it loud enough, someone will find a way to do that. But let's stay with 1914, because this is key to what we were discussing in New York, and key to what I think we want the context of this panel to be looking at. And that's that June 28th, this teenager in Sarajevo who shoots the Archduke Franz Ferdinand, and the Austro-Hungarian Empire is tumbling. It's wrath, and then revenge, and then its own destruction, which leads to the sort of what you have called the roots of breakdown, Professor Rathkolb. And let's start there, because this is really the context we need for tonight's discussion.
If I briefly can describe the situation pre-1914, I think what is important also to keep in mind when we compare the situation before 1914 with 2014, I think the first issue is that we are confronted on the one hand with a new booming economic and political power in Europe. This is Germany in 1914, which at the same time has a very strange feeling of insecurity. By the way, some of the analysts nowadays in Germany, for example, argue that Russia right now has the same feeling. I don't think so, because Germany was really on its way to becoming a very important European economic, political, cultural player. At the same time, and that's the other side of the coin, you have a declining empire. This is Austria-Hungary. Despite the fact that you have incredible innovations in different fields of science, of art in Vienna around 1900, this empire is declining. If you read the reports of the different foreign ministries, also the reports, for example, in the press, in the US around 1914, for all the analysts, it's clear that after this war, Austria-Hungary will disappear. And for me, it's also interesting to see that inside Austria-Hungary, you have the same feeling. Yeah? In this new, modern, intellectual, artistic elite of the 30s-jährige Vienna around 1900, many of them, like Arnold Schönberg, Sigmund Freud, They all felt that now this war will clean up this empire and will lead to a new power system and maybe also help modernity to take over. If you go into the old elite of Austria-Hungary, they have the same feeling, yeah, that it's a declining empire and only by going to war they will solve the problem. And I think in this miscalculation, including also the power interests of Russia, of England, of France, of Italy at the same time, I think we can understand this crazy development of alliance system. But if you see it really on a rational basis, we must say that Austria-Hungary was not even equipped from the military point of view to wage a war against Serbia, but they thought that through this war, especially backed by Germany, and therefore the German Austro-Hungarian alliance is the key, I think, in the end of the decision to wage war, that this really helped the Austrians to overcome their fears. To make a final point on this issue is that obviously the first globalization and these feelings of a declining empire, despite this high level of artistic and intellectual developments in all fields of science and art and music, for example, in particular, these feelings, I think, at the same time were so inward-looking that they did not realize that the war will not solve this problem of a declining empire at the same time. It's a paradox situation and maybe also paradox analysis for you, but if you really go into the details, I think this ambivalent situation of this booming but insecure German Empire and this declining Austro-Hungarian Empire, I think this is a key in analysis, because if you analyze, and that's my last point, the evaluations within all the power administrations, be it in Moscow, be it in Paris, be it in London, it was quite clear for them that the key issue was on how to contain Germany, but Austria-Hungary, for all of them already, was a declining empire like the Ottoman Empire.
And Professor Hansen, Oliver was just saying about this, I mean, there's a war that people thought was just housekeeping, that would just be over quickly and it would just, would reorder things and think it would be better. We know what happened. We know that the millions died and were displaced. It was chaos in Europe. And it was also something I know you have written about, which is that this, that what is left after that, after these empires dissolved, is fear and loathing. It's a seeking of an identity. It's trying to find out who you are. It's nationalism. And this is what the Austria, what this rump of Austria that was left was trying to define. Can you
talk about that? Oh, no, I think absolutely. And to all the points that Oliver made, when Austria emerged from this, of course, it went from being this extremely large, threatened but large empire to this utterly crushed rump of a state whose most coherent form of nationalist expression in the form of pan-Germanism and an effort, a desire to join Germany, which was very strong at the time, was deliberately denied by the Allies, a clear violation of Wilson's 14 points and self-determination. I think that is absolutely the case. And nationalism everywhere has two sides to it. It can be a wonderful force for solving a collective action program problem, for getting people to do things that they would not otherwise do at a group. And it has its dark side, where deep ethnic hatred, the committing of the most barbarous acts become acceptable. And an example of that, which was completely off topic, came to me when I was reading about Israel's, what Israelis call the War of Liberation, what Palestinians call the Nakba, and you were interviewing soldiers who had a year before been normal middle-class men who, in the context of this war, thought it was perfectly normal to gun down 13-year-old girls. Now, this is in no sense a criticism of Israel and Israelis, because it was nothing specific to that context. It rather goes to the Janus face, the dual-sided nature of nationalism.
Ambassador Inzko, we were hearing about earlier about this thriving culture, this Vienna coffee house world of Schoenberg and the Mahler, Gustav Klimt, Oskar Kokoschka. All these people were developing in this period in Vienna, and this Vienna was this thriving culture, also a place where we had Stalin, Tito, Hitler, Trotsky, all blocks from each other at some point or another. How do you think the politics of fear that we saw develop at this time, and you're still dealing with in your situation in Bosnia-Herzegovina, how does that develop in this situation?
Well, I was director of the Cultural Institute of Austria in Prague, and I studied a little bit this period, say 100 years ago, 120 years ago, and I was in a positive sense, I was shocked how creative this period was, you know. It was full of innovation, it was full of creativity. Some even said that the 20th century was born in Vienna. It was a huge melting pot, and all the big talents, you know, they came from Moravia, they came from Bohemia, from today's Ukraine, Lvov, Lemberg, it was part of Austro-Hungarian Empire. A new civil code was adopted and first tested in the Galicia, yeah? Krakow. These were big cities, you know, and Werfel, Kafka, Sigmund Freud was already mentioned, you know, Gregor Mendel, musicians. It was really, everybody went to Vienna, and somehow the talents which were in a way hidden, say in Galicia or in Prague not so much, but say in Moravia, it came to a positive explosion when they came to Vienna. It was really a biotope, you know, of creativity and of ideas. And it's unbelievable how the density of talents of Vienna. I think some 30 or so Nobel Prize winners were born or lived in Vienna at that time, future Nobel Prize winners, of course, which had to flee Austria and leave Austria due to Nazism. And there's a great guilt also by my countrymen. But they were all born in this region, you know. And I think we can be proud of it. It's our heritage, be it painting, be it music. Clemens can tell more, yeah, about it. Innovation, the huge infrastructure of Central Europe was created then. And when we speak about Bosnia, where I work, I almost every day meet people who say, if Austro-Hungarian Empire would still exist, yeah, we would be now in Europe, we would have even a better life than we have now. And all this, you know, that Bosnia-Herzegovina was under Ottoman Empire, like Serbia, Bulgaria, Romania, etc. And Austro-Hungarian Empire brought a huge modernization, change to Bosnia-Herzegovina. The land registry was introduced, the cadastre was introduced. They had the electric tram 1 year before Vienna, sure, yeah. Of course, for testing purposes, you know, but still. The first bus line by the postal service was established also in Bosnia-Herzegovina. And so on, you know.
Again, this is politics of fear. What do you think in the midst of this incredibly rich and fermented culture, the breakdown of the Austro-Hungarian yeah. Empire created the perfect recipe for this what Randall was
but
talking
about. But here comes the other aspect, which was mentioned by Oliver, you know, this insecurity, that this is a decaying empire, that we cannot solve the question of language in Austro-Hungarian Empire, because basically Austrians and Hungarians were dominating. The Northern Slavs and Southern Slavs didn't have the same rights. For example, Emperor Franz Joseph was not coronated in Prague, in Bohemia, only in Budapest. Ferenc Josef, he called himself, yeah, there. And in Vienna, of course, and also the Southern Slav question was not solved, you know. And this is, of course, the question of the Serbs, the Croats, Slovenians, Bosnia-Herzegovina was annexed, yeah. And so, but still, in a way, it was a future Europe in a smaller way. There were about 40, 50 million people. 16 official languages were admitted in the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and you had also a common currency like today in European Union, and the four freedoms. Yeah.
But what we have to also bring in here is anti-Semitism and the Jews, because that cultural flourishing of Vienna, it was not entirely distinct to Vienna. You had a similar cultural flourishing in Berlin, and it was inseparable from the rise of German-speaking Jews to positions of utter prominence in the arts, in science.
And medicine, then that, medicine, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And that, of course, bridges right on to fear and loathing in terms of the anti-Semitic reaction, which anti-Semitism was, of course, always there. But after World War I, in Germany, but especially in Austria, it hardened and became political, which is to say cultural anti-Semitism is excluding Jews from clubs and making sure that your daughters don't marry them and so on. Political anti-Semitism demands a policy response to the influence.
But
of
you
Jews.
Had, and Professor Rathkolb can speak to this. You had at this time a mayor of Vienna, who was extremely popular. He was keeping the trains running on time. He was doing everything right. But he was many call him the father, the first speaker of modern anti-Semitism, and he played a major role, did he not, in creating what Randall was just describing?
Yeah, but he's only part, I would say, of anti-Semitism. Karl Lueger, whom you mentioned, used and misused anti-Semitism, but also he attacked very aggressively the Hungarians, whom he hated too, to gain votes. When he became mayor, he played it in a different way. But I think the key, and you are pointing to, is that in the development of what we could call the first modernity in Austria and in Germany, there was also the development of a racist anti-Semitism, yeah, which is different to anti-Semitism in previous time. And this is the basis of national socialist anti-Semitism. Yeah, it's especially the pan-German groups, the students, for example, at the university. In 1848, during the failed revolution in Vienna, Jewish students fought together with workers against Croatian soldiers and Russian troops, by the way. And a few decades later, they were not allowed to join German fraternities anymore. You already had an exclusion of Jews on a racist basis here, and this very vigorously affected, for example, the university. And at the University of Vienna, for example, already pre-1914, we had the very strange situation that the monarchy, the administration of the empire, tried to contain anti-Semitism by establishing a chair, for example, in autonomy for Jews and one for non-Jews, with a Jewish professor and a non-Jewish professor, yeah? Which, however, meant that they accepted racist anti-Semitism. They tried to contain it, but certainly I think this was the wrong approach, which is quite different to the debate you have on anti-Semitism in France, for example. Yeah?
Professor Hellsberg, I know you have spoken of the orchestra, the Vienna Philharmonic, as being a democracy, and as something that you was part of its pride, that it had this structure, and that everyone was a member and supposedly equal within it. Where at this time, before we get into the Anschluss and what happened eventually to the orchestra and your research, how did the orchestra fit into this environment of humiliation and the feelings that people were having as the empire broke down? Where was the orchestra at that point?
Yeah, I mean, it was one of my a question which came up to me maybe some 30 years or more before. I was really in a way shocked or fascinated by the fact that an institution or a community which was from its very beginning in 1842, always democracy at the grassroots, yeah? That then, 96 years later, nearly the half of this community would join a totalitarian party, become members of a totalitarian party. So
the Nazis.
Yeah, the Nazis in 1938. So that was, I'm sure that was no difference. This democratic life within the community was not different 100 years before as it is now, and we have really a democracy there. Can believe me, I feel it, yeah.
<That's>
I feel it day by day. At the moment, not at the moment, because my colleagues are back on the way to Vienna. So all of them had this experience, and so this question is, for me, it's a burning question. Why, how was it possible?
What was it, when you go back and say, because we're going to talk quite a bit about what you revealed in your own research about what happened to the orchestra, but at this particular time, do you see the beginnings? Do you see the foundation of what you discovered later about the orchestra?
I would focus, because we have time, I think, until...
It's not 10 after 5, wondering about this, or 10 to 5.
No, so we have to focus on some points. And there are two aspects which I think are important. One is already, you mentioned the two, like a coin, the two sides of nationalism. I mean, speaking about music, it would be, it is great, yeah, to have the nationalism. What would be the world without the Czech music? What would it be without the Italian? What would it be without the German or the French music? So on the one hand, you have this richness. On the other hand, and that I'm absolutely, I know what I'm speaking about. Generations of musicians in Austria and Germany were raised in a sense, and I know that also our orchestra was indirect involved in this situation. Musicians were raised that German music, speaking about Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Bach, that this is the superior music. I mean, it's clear. I mean, Beethoven, Bach, yeah, that's the monuments of mankind. But on the other hand, that I think the perversion and the horrible mistake starts in the moment when you begin and say say this is a kind that's superior music.
But you mean in the terms of being a national music? Music is the triumph of humanity. These are great, these artists, Beethoven or Wagner, this is greatness in the music. But when they started to define it this is great German music,
no,
and the superiority of that.
This is the better music. Uh-huh. That's for me, because it's a different music. Yeah, it's just, that's the greatness. If you have the same tragedy in an opera of Mozart or Wagner, and the same in a Verdi opera, it's a totally different expression, but it has the same value.
And is that what was happening in this period of time? Was a belief that a seeking out of the superiority of the music, of looking for what would make what was great about about German music or greater than other music? Is that what you're finding? Is that there is a sense of superiority of a certain kind of music?
I believe that if somebody is raised and is dedicated to a profession, yeah, and is a musician, you are dedicated to your profession, otherwise you are not a musician. If you are raised in this sense, then and you learn and you grow up with always that you are part of the of a superior kind of art, then why shouldn't be their superior this difference also with human races.
Is this the first, an early clue for you of what was coming? Would you, because you didn't know, one didn't know, if you had been in the orchestra in the 1920s or even the early 1930s, when already there were people who had joined the Nazi Party, secretly had joined it, because it was against the law. But already in the early 1930s, in the Vienna Philharmonic, you had card-carrying Nazis. So that was an early sign, do you think, at the...
But it was not only the Vienna Philharmonic, the society and the musicians. Mm-hmm. It is, for example, it is shocking, really shocking to read letters of Arnold Schoenberg and of Anton Webern in 1914 about the war. They were enthusiastic on the war. And Schoenberg wrote it's great that he was always an enemy of this Russian and Italian and other music. And now we will win about them.
This is the extraordinary thing that was revealed in our New York panel, was we had the head of the Schoenberg Institute, who was on the with us, and he revealed, he read letters that he had translated for the first time into English, that revealed this extraordinary thing, which was that Arnold Schoenberg had been so enthusiastic about the war, the Great War, 1914, because it would clean everything up, would get rid of all these ethnic minorities that were cluttering up the Germanic spirit. This is a man who is Jewish and who later came to write another letter that he also translated, where he says that the horrors of what he saw by after the Anschluss and when everyone, as we know what happened in World War II, that letter, he said that he no longer sees himself as a German, he no longer sees himself even as a member of the human race, he sees himself as a Jew. And it was an extraordinary moment in New York when these letters were revealed. It shows the thinking of the time, and it's difficult. It's rarely you get an insight like that.
But what is really also the next shocking aspect is, I mean, when I, God thanks, I was born after the war. But when I was a boy, in Vienna, you will remember, we always saw on the street, we saw people, men with one leg, with one arm, or paralyzed. Mm-hmm. So all this, we saw what war means. We say arts and artists have always that's a glimpse into the future. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't need a war that I can imagine what it means. Yeah, I must not have seen directly what it means if a human body is hit by a bullet. I don't. Yeah, what a catastrophe that means. And I'm really, I asked myself, such a spirit, like such a mind as Schoenberg, yeah, for example, that he has not this fantasy to think, okay, what you say, clean up, but what does this clean up mean? They didn't think on millions, but each killed people is one too much, and each handicapped and wounded is one too much.
I just want to go to Professor Hansen, because I want to move into the period when your revelations about the orchestra and just the degree to which it had become part of this Nazi culture. But this is a good setting up the time when the Anschluss, when the annexation of Austria happens, when Hitler invades, and people are, my God, we didn't see this coming, we're not part of this. It's for till recently, Vienna considered to be the first victim of Hitler. How receptive was Vienna and Austria?
I'm going to pass that question on to Oliver, because he is the preeminent historian of contemporary of modern Austria. But what I want to come back to this question of Schoenberg and this thirst for war, because I think this is an important point. The most difficult thing in history is to forget what we know and only imagine what they knew. And the image of war for Europeans, all Europeans, going into 1914 was 19th century wars and colonial wars, mm-hmm. which had been short, a jaunty little war, as one British MP described them. Oddly enough, the American Civil War, which in many sense was the clearest antecedent to what became the First World War, wasn't part of the European consciousness. And I don't know anything about the specific case of Schönberg, but for German and Austrian Jews, demonstrating their nationalism, their patriotism, their hunger for war, was a way of demonstrating their assimilation. Yeah. And assimilation was part of their rise to preeminence. But you wanted to talk about 1938.
That's a very good point, but I will go to Professor Rathkolb.
Yeah, but if I just may briefly add to this, you also can see with Sigmund Freud, who really felt also being a German. Yeah, German culture was his main focus of his cultural identification. It was interesting to see that what we neglect nowadays, that, for example, the 1848 revolution and also the early German fraternities before they excluded Jews were seen as the driving forces of democracy against the authoritarian and monarchist regimes in Europe. This turned around, unfortunately, in a negative sense, around 1900. And for this group, I think really the war was also something to more or less implant the total assimilation of Jews into German and Austrian, Austro-Hungarian society. And the disaster is that it really went into the other side, both in Germany and in Austria, the Jews suddenly were part of the defeat, were responsible for the defeat. If you read the early writings of Hitler, you really get a feeling on how he constructed his so-called Dolchstoß Legende, the step from behind, which was always attributed to Jews at that time. And to come back to your question concerning 1938 and this unbelievable enthusiasm when the Nazis came to Vienna, the German Wehrmacht was welcomed, and even Hitler was so surprised by the Austrian enthusiasm when he came first to his birth town, Braunau, and then went on, cheered the whole time to Linz, that he changed his plans. Because originally he wanted a referendum in 1938 having two separate states and one president. So he being the Reichspräsident of Germany and the president of Austria. But when he saw this enthusiasm, he completely changed his view and integrated Austria in just a moment. And I think to understand this enthusiasm in 1938, we have really also go back a little bit to World War I, certainly, because this war really not only dissolved the monarchy, but destroyed Austrian society. We had, I think, very interesting new research presented in New York by colleagues from the Vienna City Library, Alfred Foser, who could show, for example, that Vienna exploded from 2 million inhabitants to 2.5 million inhabitants in 1918. 250,000 wounded soldiers. It was the largest military hospital all over Europe. Yeah? 250,000 refugees were also forced migrations from all over the monarchy, especially from Galicia. Many Jews who were fleeing the Russian front and came to Vienna or were deported to Vienna. And I think this mixture in 1918 produced a very aggressive society, which on the political level was split into 2.5 camps. Social Democrats fighting for a completely new lifestyle. On the other hand, the Christian socials who wanted to continue a more conservative lifestyle. And the only short period where the political life was functioning in Austria was until 1920, when the constitution was passed in parliament, and also social laws were produced here. And I think the main, driving force which negatively affected Austrian political life certainly were the peace treaties of Saint-Germain and Versailles, which forbade the Anschluss. This was a severe blow, for example, for the Social Democrats, because they wanted to fulfill the 1848 revolution, join a democratic, German-speaking entity.
Weimar Republic.
At that time. One, I think, other reason why anti-Semitism was so aggressive in Vienna in 1938. It was so aggressive that the new Nazi Reichskommissar für die Wiedervereinigung, for the integration of Austria, Sauckel from the Saarland, decreed in the first days that he will intervene in the plundering and looting of Jewish property, because the Viennese were so aggressive, grasping and looting at the same time. And I think it has something to do with the disastrous economic and social situation of Austria already during World War I. Vienna was a dead city in 1918, but a dead city with 2.5 million inhabitants. And this continued, I think, over the period. You see it when Germany began to find some economic better basis in the late 1920s. Austria was still declining with high rates of unemployment. And you had a very aggressive anti-Semitic propaganda against Jewish entrepreneurs, Jewish doctors, Jewish university professors, and so on. And everything was attributed, the mismanagement of the economy was attributed to a Jewish conspiracy, to put it bluntly.
But how much of that explains the situation as your research, Professor Hellsberg, when you were able to get into the archives finally, very recently, to actually find out just how many members of the orchestra were Nazis? Almost half of them, two SS members, that with a society in Austria of only 10% who were card-carrying Nazis. So this is an extraordinarily high percentage. These are people, as we were
but
just
I
discussing.
Think there's a reason also to it. As far as I know, of course, there's no excuse, and I don't want to relativize anything. But every member of the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra was also a member of the state opera. And as a member of the state opera, he was a civil servant. And it is known that civil servants had a higher percentage of membership. If you had an orchestra which was just an orchestra, a symphony orchestra, and not civil servants, the percentage was lower. But in the Vienna State Opera and Philharmonics are both, They are a society, a democratic society, but also they are civil servants when they are in the opera. And I think this was one of the reasons, not an excuse, but this was one of the reasons, because the percentage with civil servants was always higher.
How far does that go to explain it, Professor Hellsberg?
I mean, I would say it. Yeah, it is some explanation. Also, an explanation is that I think that the people, that the members of the orchestra were afraid. That they would then become members of the Wehrmacht. The colleagues in Berlin were not in this danger because they were under the Sonder von Goebbels, the Berlin Philharmonic.
The Berlin Philharmonics were directly administered and taken over by the Reichspropaganda Ministry.
And only 10% of Berlin members were found to be card-carrying Nazis of the orchestra.
Yeah, but they were not a danger to become soldiers. The Vienna Philharmonic, theoretically, yes. Practically, it was just one member, what I know, who was forced to come to the Wehrmacht and who died a few weeks later in the front. But they were always in danger, so maybe. That is also an explanation why many thought they would be on the safe side as members of the party, which was
wrong. If I may add something, I think what you have said is very important, because the so-called illegal cell, as you said, between 1933 and 38, the Nazi Party for the most time was forbidden in Austria, started in the state opera. There the organization was very tough. One of the reasons, and that's quite different to Germany or the Berlin Philharmonics, we must always take into account that we had a chancellor's dictatorship between 1933 and 38. And there was, on the one hand, the chairman of the Vienna Philharmonic, and Clemens Hellsberg has written extensively on this in his book already in 1992, was very close to the political regime of Dollfuss and later especially of Schuschnigg. They even fought Clemens Krauss and on a very personal level, and more or less pushed him out of Vienna towards Berlin and Hitler at the same time. And there was a strong opposition of part, especially the younger musicians, against this political president of the orchestra. And this also explains part of the group joining the Nazi party. And that's different to the Berlin Philharmonics. Yeah, you hadn't this dictatorship before the Nazis took over, and they were immediately taken over by the Reich's propaganda ministry, which for them was a comfortable position, because they got enough money, they were not in danger to be taken to the Wehrmacht. In Vienna, the situation was different, because in the first decision, if I remember correctly, your book, the orchestra as an independent entity was dissolved. Yeah. And then this decision was revoked with quite a lot of pressure.
Now, these institutional explanations are absolutely valid and are certainly part of the explanation, but one wouldn't, and I know neither of you is doing this, one would not want to give the impression that the Vienna Philharmonic was not more Nazified than the Berlin Philharmonic, because it was. But Austria was more Nazified than Germany. And the evidence for that is in joining the National Socialist Party, joining the Wehrmacht, and above all, being massively overrepresented in the killing instruments of the SS. And so the question then becomes, did the Vienna Philharmonic lead this or simply reflect broader trends? This is your area. My hypothesis would be the latter. And then that takes on to your research, Professor, in explaining the deeper ideological commitment to National Socialism in Austria and the more violent expression of that commitment. And you've already talked about that.
I think that's a good argument, because on the one hand, you're absolutely right that there was an unbelievable trend in the Nazi party in 38 and already 37, 36. It has something to do that this democracy was dissolved. Social Democrats had been outlawed after a civil war in 34. There was no really democratic resistance against National Socialism anymore. And one of the reasons also is that, and that's very strange, and I just finished an article when I flew over the Atlantic on the first Reichskommissar and later Gauleiter in Vienna, Josef Bürkel, and he was a so-called Reichs-German. That means he was sent by Hitler to Vienna to destroy the Austrian old Nazi clique, yeah, because they were a crazy group, very aggressive, a lot of terrorists attacked, but they were not able to organize themselves like the Germans did. That means suddenly you had a German, Reichs-German Nazi elite in Austria, and the old Austrian Nazi elite was not really able to get the jobs they wanted, except the Carinthian group, which very well was able to adapt here. That means the Austrian Nazis always felt as underdogs, and that also, by the way, explained when they had the options to get positions, like you said, in the concentration camps. They took all their comrades and friends from SS with them to Poland and other occupied territories and functioned as the butchers of the Nazi regime. Yeah? It's a very strange reaction, yeah, being the underdog and suddenly being the dominating power.
Professor Hellsberg, what happened? to the Jews in the orchestra in 1938?
Yeah, it was immediately after, in March 1938. The Jewish members were immediately dismissed.
How many?
11 plus and one political dismissal, and Burkhauser. And
there were 16 altogether, were there not?
No, six other members of the orchestra, retired members, came in the concentration camps. The other could escape. From the retired members, five were murdered in the concentration camps. One died when he was taken in prison. So he had a stroke or a heart attack. Yeah. So we had six colleagues who were murdered, and the others were forced to flee.
And you call them colleagues, and because again that idea that you see the orchestra as this democracy, and they are will always be your colleagues.
But there's
how do you feel about that? Because you didn't know this when you. You were a member of the orchestra, as we said at the beginning. You could have just gone on to your whole career and ignored this.
Yeah, but I must say, as I am grandfather in March, I've become 62 this March. But as a Vienna Philharmonic, as a human being, I'm 62. As a Vienna Philharmonic, I'm 172 years. By chance, both Vienna Philharmonic and I have birthday on the same day.
Well done.
March 28th, but Vienna Philharmonic is 110 years older than me. But I, as Vienna Philharmonic, I feel that I'm 172 years old, because we say, we were the orchestra, or we are the orchestra, which premiered Bruckner's 2nd, 4th, 6th, 8th symphony, Brahms' 2nd, 3rd and 3rd symphony, Mahler's 9th symphony, who premiered Frauen und Schatten at the State Opera. That are we. If I say this, then I cannot say at the same in the next moment, all of the current members, all of them are born after the war. So the guys who were the Nazis, that were those guys. No. We are responsible for all the 172 years.
Because they were also your colleagues, the Nazis.
Because, and also the murdered. We have to be aware of the responsibility for all the history, because that's the only way to solve or to find a way to help with our weak, to help to solve the problems of the future.
But
that's the only way.
The two of you, when you went into the archives that had not been opened for decades, that people, whether they were lost or hidden, and found out the numbers of Jews who had what had happened to them, and found out the history of what had happened to that orchestra, and found out its past. The past wasn't so past. You both have revealed that this resistance to this knowledge of the orchestra went on into the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, to the present day.
I must say, it was already Otto Strasser wrote about all the colleagues who were murdered.
But then you also noticed, only recently revealed the degree to which they were still honoring Nazis who were getting out in the 60s by giving them the ring of the Philharmonic.
I think, if I may add a little bit, what's very interesting also dealing with the history of the Vienna Philharmonics is that each generation finds a new perspective to the orchestra. Yeah? For example, Clemens, Hellsberg was the first one to write about the full biographies of the persecuted and killed Jewish members of the orchestra already in 1988, 2 years after the Waldheim debate started. He was the first one who, in 1992, in his very thick book, Demokratie der Könige, Democracy of Kings, wrote about this high percentage of membership in the orchestra. What we now found, I think, and that was for me the most striking experience in the cellar of the state opera, in a room where normally there only should be opera scores and not material of the Vienna Philharmonics, which goes back, by the way, to also World War I. The correspondence of the chair of the orchestra. And the interesting thing was that there were a number of letters of the Nazi president and SS member, Jerger, to the office of the Gauleiter and later on also the Reichsleiter, Baldur von Schirach, trying to intervene and save the pensioned old colleagues, because everybody knew that deportation from Vienna, be it to Theresienstadt or be it into the East, will mean for the old members a first step towards death. And what for me, and I think for all of us, was striking is the language in which these letters were formulated. They were in presented not as Jews, but as former colleagues, yeah, who had also an artistic contribution to the orchestra. And the orchestra was, for example, in 1938, successful in getting one of the members out of the concentration camp Dachau, Geiringer, and intervened, but were not successful with Schirach. And what for me is really striking, if you read the minutes of
Nuremberg.
The Nuremberg trials concerning Baldur von Schirach. He presented him as the savior of Austrian arts, a very nice Reichsleiter, has nothing to do with the deportation of Jews. This was only the bad SS and Reichssicherheitshauptamt, the Gestapo. And he even said it in a famous TV interview, which you can look up on YouTube, when he was released from prison in the late 1960s, that he has nothing to do with the deportation of Jews. But he was responsible. It would have been very easy for him, in his position, to save these few Jewish musicians, but he was not interested. And he praised himself in a secret meeting that he made Vienna Judenfrei, free of Jews, and that he will start now to make Vienna free of Czechs. Yeah? Mm-hmm. That means he completely reversed his position in the Nuremberg trial and presented himself as a good guy within this Nazi clique.
We're going to go to the audience for questions, but I have to ask some questions of Ambassador Inzko, because when we're talking about this, these unifying principles that arts can represent, this opportunity to have all ethnicities in the democracy. One of the big issues I know you're dealing with in Bosnia-Herzegovina is that all the national arts organizations, the ones that are pan-ethnic, are either closed down or about to close down. There's no heat in those buildings, there's no lights, no one's being paid their salaries. What are you up against, and how can you possibly get the arts engaged in this once again in your country, in Bosnia?
Yeah, just allow me to say one sentence. Being a Slovenian by heritage, we lived in our village for about 500 years in Austria. We are the last remnants of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, yeah. And we had also resistance in Nazi time. About 200 people have died in our territory in the south of Austria. And of course, many Austrians were collaborating with Nazism. It's absolutely true. But it's also true that Austria was a victim as a state of Nazism, because it disappeared for 7 years. It didn't exist for 7 years until 45. Yeah. And also, for example, in our churches, Slovenian language was forbidden. We couldn't pray. I mean, my parents and my grandparents couldn't pray in Slovenian. It was forbidden for 7 years. Yeah. And there was a strong resistance movement. Altogether, 800 people were killed in our territory, but some of them came from Slovenia, from Yugoslavia, but 150 were from Austria. Yeah, so there was an organized resistance. Yeah, as far as art is concerned, it is true that the National Museum is closed in Bosnia and Herzegovina at the moment. National Library is closed. As a library, as a building, it will be opened by the Vienna Philharmonic on the 28th of June. Thank you, Clemens.
The anniversary of the assassination.
Yes.
Of
National Film Archive, etc., is closed for different reasons. The three constituent people cannot agree on the financing. Yeah,
disturbs the
and this is very
and
sad.
Bosnians.
Yeah, but I would like to stress really one issue: art was the strongest resistance during the war. Not a single theater performance was canceled during the war. Maybe it was 3 hours late or 4 hours late, but it was never canceled. This was a form of resistance.
In Sarajevo.
In Sarajevo was under siege for 4 years. Nobody could get out. Nobody could get in. And only with special permission or with United Nations forces, etc. Or if you paid a lot of money, and artists had no money, of course. But this was a form of resistance. And people are very proud, even today, 18 years after the war has ended, that this kept them alive, you know. The arts, and this should not be forgotten.
Yeah, no, Professor Hansen, you want to respond to that?
Well, I suppose it opens up the conversation into something that we might not have time to get into, except in questions, and that's the question of why valiant efforts have been made since the Waldheim affair, and both of you have been involved in them, but why Austria took so long to come to terms with its past, and the usual explanation you get in the literature is the Moscow Declaration of 1943, which made Austria the first victim of National Socialism, which was actually designed to encourage resistance in Austria against National Socialism. It did not work. And the second one was the State Treaty of 1955, where very much at the last moment, the Chancellor of Austria struck out a provision attributing responsibility for the war to Austria. But I think we have to think about something else. And that takes us back to where we began. Nationalism, because the question is, why did everyone, including Austria themselves, allow those two legal tricks to do the work? And if we think about German nationalism versus Austrian nationalism in the post-war period, German nationalism was by definition the enemy, responsible for this total horror, this mass murder. Austrian nationalism was the friend. Why? Because in the early post-war period, the great fear of nationalism in Austria was a fear of pan-German nationalism, trying to reattach itself to Germany. Austrian nationalism was to be allowed to be encouraged. In that context, where Austrian nationalism is a good thing rather than a great evil, in the context of the Moscow Declaration and in the context of the 1955 State Treaty, then the myth of Austria as a victim could carry on for decades, and that Austrians themselves signed up to that is not particularly surprising. Yeah. It's as normal for people
as
for countries.
We have to go to, there's a red microphone and a green microphone. And so we have only a very short period of time for questions. I would urge you not to make any, if you have things you want to say, you can say to the panelists later, quickly into questions if you could. And so just questions, please. I'll start, is that the red one or is the green one? Is that blue? Red, okay.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for this absorbing discussion. Hearing you talk about the enthusiasm of the Anschluss and the overrepresentation of party members among the ranks of the Philharmonic, I'm reminded of an old joke that post-war Austrian foreign policy consisted of convincing the world that Beethoven was Austrian and Hitler was German. Hitler, of course, himself commemorated his birth on the border of the two great German nations, etc., and fought in the First World War and experienced the debacle and the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian Empire after the First World
Your
War.
Question, please.
The question is, do you not see, how can we be surprised at the enthusiastic reception of Hitler in Austria? Hitler, a son of Austria, if you like, and the putative redeemer of the losses that the Austro-Hungarian Empire had suffered after the First World War. And how can we be surprised at the overrepresentation of party members among the ranks of the Philharmonic when Hitler's credo was a romantic credo and the privileging that was spoken of the German arts over the arts of the rest of the world.
Thank you. Well, let the two historians answer this question. Professor Rathkolb, do you want to begin?
May I add something to you? I have another explanation to the victims theory. There are two reasons for it, including plus the reasons you already have mentioned. First, Stalin, and then second, the Cold War. Yeah, because Stalin was only interested in weakening Germany. When the Red Army freed Vienna on the 13th of April, 1945, just 2 weeks later, a provisional government was established with a declaration which was the core document of the victims' doctrine. The communists, for example, were very unhappy with this situation because the Russians were not interested in denazification compared with the Americans or the British. I think that's the first one. The second reason is why these victim theories was so well planted in the international environment is the Cold War. Yeah? Yeah. Because it was important to reintegrate the Nazis very early on to have a strong power against a possible Soviet move against the West. I think this also explains the victim's doctrine.
Okay, I'm going to get Professor Hansen to answer the gentleman's questions.
Well, the general answer is that nothing is inevitable in history, and most historical outcomes are, in a sense, to be explained because nothing caused them to happen. There were other traditions in Austria. You correct me if I'm wrong, the Social Democratic Party was about 40% of the vote, in, or 40% support in the 1930s, and the triumph of a murderous, extremist, racist, anti-Semitic tradition over a inclusive, liberal, democratic, social democratic one was no more inevitable in Austria than it was in Germany. This is part of the story of how history turned out as it did.
Is this the green microphone? All right, then you can talk now.
Just a quick question. How much of what you've exposed tonight is permeating into Austrian society? Because all of these things have permeated into German society. This is a very, let's say, elite level discussion. Is what you're saying, is it being understood by Austrian school children, by Austrian university students, by the mass public? In essence, do we have mass knowledge now?
I think that's part of your question, last few words.
Do we have mass knowledge?
Do we have mass knowledge that you have in Germany, for example? Do you have mass knowledge in Austria?
Get the question.
Mass knowledge?
Does everybody know
whether this debate has reached a society? Yeah, exactly. I'm well prepared for this question. I have the most recent unpublished public opinion poll, which we just have conducted in February 2014. And we also tried to analyze the issue of the Holocaust, also the responsibility, for example, of Austrians for the fates concerning Jews between 1938 and 1945. And, for example, a clear yes to this issue of a responsibility for the fate of Jews is 52% of society, yes, but, and I think this is also a task for further debate, that 43% say no. That means there is a majority. It's not a minority discourse you are hearing here. It has reached society. If you take public opinion polls among students, you have a quite higher also critical perspective concerning National Socialism, but you have a relatively strong group which disagrees, and I think therefore activities like the Vienna Philharmonics have said are very important to rediscuss and reanalyze the Nazi history.
But Professor Rathkolb, do these numbers, do they give you comfort or do they give you concern?
No, they give me neither comfort nor concern, but I think they remind us that this issue is still negotiated in society. If I get you the public opinion polls 10 years ago, there would be a clear-cut majority that the Austrians have nothing to do with the fate of the Jews. This has changed in society, but still it's 52%. It's if you take it in Germany, the number would be much higher, I would say 60-70% or so.
And
it's a duty, I think.
You have spoken elsewhere that, to some extent, the blame has shifted from the Jews to other minorities in Austria.
This is, I think, the next difficult problem. So if we ask, for example, and we did that, a simple question, we have as a result of the monarchy one of the earliest religious laws concerning the Islamic community because of Bosnia-Herzegovina. Yeah? When we ask the question whether the Austrians say the Muslims should have the right to build mosques in Austria, we only, and now this is a really tough figure, we only have 24% who say yes and 74% no. And this is a disastrous answer. Yeah? You know, on the one hand, we are happy with this law, this old tradition. We have a huge mosque which was built in 1974 with the cardinal being at the ceremony, Bruno Kreisky, near the future UN center. But nowadays, there's a very, very tough issue with regard to Turks, for example, Muslims, as this answer shows in society.
And the green microphone, do we have another question there? Red mic, sorry.
Thank you. My question is specifically to Dr. Hellsberg. Dr. Hellsberg, currently, how do you see the Vienna's financial supporters, Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra's financial supporters, and the general public, how do they see you currently with respect to these issues which we are discussing today?
As Vienna Philharmonic, we have no public subsidies. And we live from our income, from the tickets, and from our engagements all over the world. We have one exclusive partnership with Rolex. This is it's clear that they watch all our steps, yeah, and we discuss these issues also with them, but it does not affect our relationship because they trust us that we would continue with the way we are convinced which is the right one. And I mean, in Berkeley, when we had a similar symposium
in California,
I was asked what I would think, because you have this polls, these figures. I was asked whether my colleagues would agree with these activities or not. And my answer was easy. We have always a 3 years term in all our functions, and then we are re-elected or not. I'm serving now for 17 years. So the colleagues must be agree with this. We have the support, and it was a major step to bring also not only a professional historian close to our orchestra, but also with Professor Rathkolb, he's also in Austria really an authority. And the book you mentioned, you forgot to say that I was, for a major part in this, I was also, it was based on your research 1 year before.
I was a little bit faster.
I think that we are already 5 minutes over. I'm looking for a signal from somebody as to whether or not I can take another question.
I have a question to Clemens, yeah?
Well, no, I'm saying it. We're going to take it from the audience, and we have to go to the green microphone, right? So, you have the green microphone, so your question is on.
I was in Bayreuth in Germany last summer, where the Wagner Opera Festival is held every summer. And in front of the Festspielhaus, there was a memorial for each of the musicians and singers that were deported in the late 30s. I'm wondering if the Vienna Philharmonic is considered doing the same thing in front of the house.
Yeah, we have it in our museum. In our Vienna Philharmonic has a museum in the so-called Haus der Musik in Vienna. Part of this is our historic archive is located there, and our museum. And in our museum, all the murdered and all the musicians who had were forced to flee have their biography there for all the visitors.
We're going to take a break. We're going to come back afterwards. You're going to, musicians are going to set up, real musicians, not the Irish dancers, I promised you. No.
It's 1 second.
All right, okay.
How many nationalities you have in the Vienna Philharmonic today, if it's not a secret?
No, it's not a secret, but I didn't make a research, but I would say between, close to 15.
How many Jews?
Sorry, I don't know. Okay. I'm just interested in good musicians.
All right, I get one last question. How many women?
Grandma.
Aha, uh-huh, you see?
We are the only...
There are many more battles to
we
fight.
Are the only top orchestra. Yeah, but it's coming now. Which has a female concertmaster.
Oh, how many women in the orchestra?
12.
We're going to take a break, and we're going to come back. Some amazing musicians. We're going to have some Schubert and some Dvorak. It's just before you all run out the door, just thank Oliver Rathkolb, Clemens Hellsberg, Randall Hansen, and Valentin Inzko for a fabulous job they did for us tonight. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. I was glad that you came up with this question.